Tonight's topic is family law. Marriage dissolution is the most common legal proceeding in the United States, affecting at least half of all married adults. Disputes in a divorce include division of assets, property, and money, as well as custody and visitation with children. Sometimes custody and child support issues arise even when there's been no dissolution. Good evening, and welcome to Lawyers on the Line. I'm Stephanie Balmer, a partner with the Falsani, Balmer, Peterson, and Quinn Law Firm, and this evening's moderator. I'm pleased to welcome our panelists, Cheryl Prince of the Hanft Fride Law Firm, and Terry Trogdon of the Gerlach Beaumier and Trogdon Law Firm. We're ready for your questions. Call locally at 218-788-2844, or if that's long distance for you, call our toll-free line at 1-877-307-8762. And now, on to tonight's discussion. We've already had a couple of questions come in. Cheryl, let's start with you. Do I need an attorney to get divorced?
You do not need an attorney to get divorced. If you and your spouse are able to reach a resolution yourselves and talk through the issues, there are forms you can get online. If you go to the Minnesota Court Administrator's website, they have pro se forms, and you can complete them, fill them out. I will warn people who are interested in doing that that the forms are very long. They have to be everything to everybody, so there tends to be a lot more detail than the statute would require at a minimum. And so sometimes people find that if the forms are overwhelming, go to a lawyer. A lawyer is going to charge you a few hours of time to draft the documents, but you're not going to be paying thousands of dollars. If you feel you can do it yourself, do it yourself. You certainly, but I also suggest that if individuals try to do it themselves, they might still want to take it to a lawyer. Just make sure they haven't forgotten any of the details.
I think I would agree wholeheartedly with Cheryl, but also, even though the forms are detailed to cover a lot of different things, everyone has different circumstances. So there might be something that you need to have addressed in your divorce that's not included in those forms. So just having a checklist of what is not in there is sometimes helpful, and an attorney can help you with that.
Okay. All right. Here's a question from a Minnesota resident. I live in Minnesota. My husband lives in Wisconsin. Where will the divorce be? Terry, let's start with you.
That's a jurisdiction issue. Jurisdiction is which state's laws are going to apply. And the different states have different residency requirements. If they have both been living in their separate states for 6 months or more, they kind of had a choice. Whoever files first can file in the state that they choose. And if they have lived in a state less than 6 months and they want to file in that state, they may be able to file for a legal separation to start with and then perhaps convert it to a divorce or dissolution later. Before choosing which state, whoever's going to file and serve first is going to want to consider which state is more advantageous. So it's kind of double the work of the forms, and forms are available in both states, but evaluating which is going to apply best to you is really sometimes difficult.
So that might be a situation where someone might want to just start by consulting a lawyer who's licensed in both states.
That's an excellent idea, because okay, there are different provisions in Wisconsin than Minnesota. The child support calculation is different. Marital property is defined differently, those kinds of things.
And if there are children, then it's more clear, because there's something called the UCCJEA, which is Uniform Child Custody, Jurisdiction, and Enforcement Act. And the definition of a child's home state is where that child has resided for the last 6 months. That is the state in which the custody and parenting time decisions are going to have to be made. So then there's not as much latitude.
Okay. Here is a question. My ex's parents want my children to visit them. Can they make me? Cheryl?
There is something called grandparents' rights. Okay. Grandparents can ask for visitation with their grandchildren. However, there are certain requirements that need to be met. First, there needs to have already had been a legal proceeding. So if the parties have been divorced, there has already been that proceeding. Then they need to establish to the court that it is in the best interest of the children that they have this time, and it will not interfere with the parents' rights to parent their children. Generally, courts want the grandparents to see the children through their child. So if husband and wife are both opposed to grandparents seeing the children, that's when the grandparents ordinarily would bring their proceeding.
Okay.
If it is a father has parenting time with his children, then the courts are going to expect, under most circumstances, that the grandparents will see the children on their child's time.
Oh, I see. Okay, it's not much as much of an issue if, okay, I understand. And do the courts look favorably in a general sense on granting grandparents this visitation, or is it really very fact specific?
I'd say that it's really case specific.
Okay.
If you have an intact family, it's going to be tough regardless. But if you have a family that has already been divided or disrupted because of legal proceedings, and the grandparents are going to be a stabilizing force, the court is going to look very favorably on that.
Okay.
And again, the prerequisite is that there already has to have been a proceeding relative to those children.
Yes.
A divorce, okay. A legal separation, a paternity, some sort of action affecting this family. It can't just be a mom and a dad that are married and they are on the outs with the in-laws.
Interesting. Here is a question from a caller. They were divorced 12 years ago. They had a retirement fund. The self-employed husband hid his assessment. So only she has to contribute to him. Can she go back after him? It sounds like maybe there was some misrepresentation in the divorce as far as assets and things like that. Is there a timeline on going back and reopening a divorce? Is that possible?
It's difficult.
Okay.
And it's not favored in any way. But if there is a fraud committed,
okay,
that is the reason that a divorce would be reopened and the award would be altered in some way.
Okay. I imagine that'd be a pretty high bar to prove.
Mm-hmm. It's tough.
Okay.
It's very
okay.
Tough.
All right. Cheryl, here's a question from a caller. What is the standard in a divorce and dividing up house value? Is it based on the tax statement, maybe the property tax value, or a realtor as far as valuing the property?
The property is valued at the fair market value.
Okay.
And so often people will look to the tax statement and agree that that is a fair assessment of value. Other times you can have a realtor or several realtors come in and do a market analysis. Usually you can get the realtors to do that for no cost.
Oh.
Otherwise, if there's really a contentious divorce or if you cannot agree on a market valuation, a court will look to an appraiser. And again, that's going to cost you some money to have the house really appraised by a real estate appraiser.
Okay.
So there are other things you can do to try to keep the cost to a minimum.
Okay. Terry, here's a question. Do I need an attorney for a post-divorce mediation to renegotiate visitation?
You don't need one.
Okay.
For that.
Is it a good idea?
It's a good idea to do a consultation.
Okay.
With an attorney, because if your mediation is not successful, you need to know what could happen then. That could be a motivator to either reach an agreement or not. And I think having a clear idea of what the legal standards are, what your rights are, influences your ability to negotiate on your own behalf. However, if there's a mediation and the opposing party, your former spouse or the other parent, has an attorney, it's probably a good idea to go in with one for yourself also, so that you know that someone else is evaluating information to be sure it's correct.
Okay. Cheryl, here's a caller question. My husband has moved out of the house. Can I change the locks?
Yes, you can change the locks.
Okay.
I'm assuming that this is the house that both husband and wife have been living in during their marriage, and yes, you can change the locks.
Okay.
Doesn't mean that he can't break in, but you can change the locks. It's as much your property as it is his property, and then he can break in because it's his property as much your property.
Okay. Could
and
he
change
then
the locks.
And change the locks.
He could change them back.
I've had
okay.
that happen.
You have. All right. Here's a question for you, Terry. Can my spouse and I use the same lawyer for our divorce if we agree on everything?
Not really.
Okay.
In fact, it's possible, but most lawyers will say, no, I can only represent one person. That is the person that I'm going to advocate for, and I'm also going to make sure that I advise them. Doesn't mean I can't, that attorney can't talk to the other person, but the other person is going to also be advised to seek separate counsel. It's more likely to use the same attorney if the attorney is functioning solely as a mediator and not advising people about the wisdom or not of a settlement agreement, but rather just raising issues and leaving all of the decision making up to the parties. But that has to be clearly disclosed. And for either situation, the important thing is that whichever party has the attorney and whichever doesn't, that it's clear what the attorney's role is to both people.
You know, I think it's very important to emphasize that a lawyer cannot represent a husband and a wife in a divorce. Okay. There can be only, sometimes there are divorces where there only is one lawyer, but that lawyer is either acting as a neutral, a mediator, or is representing one person but not the other. Sometimes I get people who have come to me after the divorce is over and they're confused because they were working with a lawyer and that there was only one lawyer, and they said that this person said they were representing both of us. Ethically, that is impossible. If the lawyer is doing that, they are acting unethically and they can get into trouble with the state board.
It is an inherent conflict of interest,
yeah,
and it can't be waived.
That makes sense. Okay. Caller question. My divorce judgment says my ex has to get my name off the mortgage or the note. That hasn't happened. What can I do? Cheryl, let's start with you.
Okay. The ex-spouse is supposed to get the name off the mortgage, you probably are going to need to go back to court, make a motion seeking to compel the spouse to act in the way that they were supposed to act. You can ask for attorney's fees. Maybe you'll get them, maybe you won't. Okay.
And even then, it may not be possible because the court can only make orders for those who are parties to it, and the lender is not a party to the action. So it usually requires that there be a refinance in the name of the person who was supposed to carry the note forward.
Oh boy. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But
it's a tough one.
It is. Okay. But I've also had in those situations where the spouse is supposed to get the name off, can't get it refinanced. If there are issues that are occurring to the non-owner spouse, credit rating is going down because the spouse is late, they can't get their own mortgage because their name stays on that mortgage. I've had a court order that the property be sold. Now it's important to recognize that in those situations there was a requirement in the divorce decree that the name be removed from the mortgage, or it became part of a court order later on for some other reason. So
okay.
And a lot of times people, when they get divorced, especially if they don't have attorneys, they don't realize that unless there is a requirement for a refinance, or unless there's a refinance later, that both spouses remain on the mortgage. So there's a divorce, one spouse gets the house, unless there's a refinance and the name is removed, that person no longer owns the house, they've signed a quitclaim deed, but they stay on the mortgage to that property and it can follow them.
And I think it's important also to know that one advantage of using an attorney is so that the attorney can incorporate into that judgment and decree what will happen ahead of time if that doesn't happen. So it might be that the person who's getting the house and supposed to be the sole responsible party on the note, if they can't do that, that right in the judgment and decree it can say that the other party then takes control of the sale.
Okay.
And then sells the house and divides however.
Puts in basically a safety net or follows it so that the parties don't have to go back to court and start all over again.
Okay. It's a remedy that's built in.
Okay. All right. Let's see. What is the benefit of having a mediation for divorce? Terry, you guys have both been talking a lot about mediations and alternative dispute resolution. Why would somebody do that?
Well, and I think Cheryl and I both have quite a bit of experience with mediations. There's a couple of reasons. One is that it usually is less expensive than a divorce, and that's the first thing people think of. But mediation is also a private and confidential process. So the information that's exchanged, financial information, is not in a court record. The arguments about the bad things everybody's done is not public. The only thing that is recorded then is the findings of fact, conclusions of law, judgment, and decree, which is something that can be pretty neutral. So in order to maintain privacy, especially if you have children, mediation is a good idea. It's also faster.
Yeah, and mediation allows people to create remedies that a court wouldn't ordinarily order. A judge listens to a husband, they listen to a wife, but they got a lot of cases going on. They're not going to come up with the same level of detail that the parties sit down in mediation and work out. The parties are the ones who know best what they need and what is important to them, and they can build that into this contract. Okay. A judge is going to just put something down that's going to solve the problem, and certainly they do their they really do try very hard to make sure that the orders that they enter are what the parties need, but they're not going they're just not going to have that same level of detail.
And you can get creative.
And you
with
can
the
get
mediation.
Creative, exactly.
Okay. All right. as kids age through an existing divorce, can they choose who they want to live with? Do they have to spend time with a parent if they don't want to? As a child of divorced parents, I would really have appreciated knowing this many years ago. What's the rule?
When you're 18, you can decide.
Okay, what about before then?
No.
You
no.
don't get to decide.
No.
And there's, and even though the children's, their opinion, what they want, is factored in, and it's more important as they get older, they still don't get to make the decision. They don't have the knowledge, they don't have the maturity, but also I think if we kind of think about asking children to make that decision, and then the child deciding that they're wrong could be quite a burden. So on many
point.
Levels, mm-hmm. we don't leave it up to the kids. And yes, they have to go.
Okay. Here's a question. If a child is meant to be visiting with a non-custodial or someone they're not living with most of the time at least, and they refuse, what happens then, Cheryl?
That's really one of the most difficult situations in a divorced family when you have a child who is refusing to go. I always tell my clients you have to do everything you can to encourage that child to go. I tell the other parent that you need to go and try to do the best you can to get the child to go, but you can't really drag a child kicking and screaming out of the house. However, there's a reason why this child doesn't want to go, and so hopefully the parents have the insight and the understanding to get this child into counseling, family counseling, to try to figure out what's going wrong and what's how you can fix it. It's a very difficult situation, and it's unfortunate when it happens.
Children are all different. Some children do well with the transfer and the exchange. Some kids just don't like to change anything anytime. Mm-hmm. And it's really up to the parents to have insight into their kids.
Okay. A couple has been together for 2 years. They are not married. Is the money that they're spending on maintaining each other's vehicles recoverable if it doesn't work out? Terry.
Ooh, that's kind of a common question, and it usually doesn't just apply to vehicles, but many different things. And the short answer is probably not going to have any sort of recourse. Unless you can show unjust enrichment, where someone has benefited outrageously.
So a lot of money, maybe.
A lot of money, and okay. pretty clear that it was not just taking care of somebody, that somebody's vehicle, not a gift, because that's always an issue. But somehow there's a person who's been enriched for something that they didn't really earn, and it wasn't intended.
Okay.
Yeah, when you're not married, you don't have the protections of the divorce law if you break up. So if you're living in the house owned by one person, no matter how long you've lived together, no matter how much labor you might have put into fixing up the kitchen or the bathroom, unless you can really show the unjust enrichment that Terry was talking about, that house and the value of that house goes with the owner's spouse or the owner of it.
Okay. So there is a benefit to getting married.
There is a benefit to getting married.
That's one benefit.
Nope, my husband's
yes.
not watching. Just kidding. In a case of bankruptcy where only one of two people in a marriage are party, how do you protect the rights of the non-bankruptcy seeking party in a divorce? Who wants to answer that, if it made sense? And it may be a bankruptcy question. I'm not sure.
I think it is a bankruptcy question, but it's part of, it fits in with divorces. There are situations where when people are divorcing, someone says, I'll take all the property and I'll take all the debt because it adds up to zero. And then you get zero too. And then the person who takes the debt and the property files bankruptcy to discharge the debt, and they still have the property.
Okay.
The other person is not protected in that instance. They are just simply...
They lose.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're the victim of a bad deal.
Okay. Cheryl, can I get a refund of the marriage license fee if the marriage doesn't work out?
Not that I know of. That's just like a driver's license fee if you crash your car. You can't get a refund of the marriage license fee.
An interesting question. We talked a little bit about grandparents' rights already. My wife says she won't give me a divorce. I need one. What can I do? Terry, you want to start with that one?
She can't stop you. You can go ahead and file for divorce. In Minnesota, it's a no-fault divorce state. A person who doesn't want a divorce can delay things, but eventually the person who wants the divorce and started it is going to get it. You only have to have one person say, this isn't working, to have an irreconcilable difference or a marital breakdown.
Mm-hmm. All right. Cheryl, here's a good question. I want a divorce, but I don't want to tell my spouse yet. Is there anything I should be doing to prepare?
One of the things I suggest to people I see in that situation is to start getting as much information as you can. Tax returns, pay stubs, retirement account statements, information about the house purchase and the equity in the house. That's starting to gather the financial records that you're going to need when you get divorced. Especially if you have them, then you know that they can't disappear if one person decides they want to get divorced. And it is very helpful to have that to begin with. So.
Okay, and what I'm also hearing in this question is, you know, should I start moving money around, moving assets? I'm not asking either of you to talk about that, but I would assume that there's a look back period in a divorce proceeding as far as what's been happening, what these balances look like.
Part of any divorce is discovery or the exchange of financial information. So as you move through that, assuming that you do it in a more formal way, you're going to find out that there was $20,000 in the bank account 6 months ago and $20,000 is missing out of the bank account now. Where did it go? You're going to have to answer that question. So it's not advisable to start moving money around. You're going to get caught. You get caught, you're going to look bad.
Okay.
Not saying that people haven't done it and gotten away
with it,
but I don't think it's the best course of action.
Okay. Is there common law marriage in Minnesota? And if so, what is the time period? Terry?
No.
Okay. I've just received divorce papers to sign, but the husband's age is wrong. Does that make the papers wrong? Would they be binding if she signed them? That's interesting. So a minor error or defect in the divorce papers.
If it's just the initial summons and petition, what the person is being asked to sign is just an admission, which says, yes, I got those documents, not I agree or disagree with them. If it's a ministerial error, clerical error on an age, and it goes forth and it becomes an order, it's not going to void the order. But the person could certainly cross out the age and initial the change and then sign the document if they really want to sign it in that way. Or give the person who wrote it up a call and say, can you get me a new one?
Oh, okay. What all lawyer parents do with the field trip permission slips, crossing out and initialing. And all right, Cheryl, what happens if one party does not follow through with getting the necessary papers/deeds filed as per the court order, such as for the home? What is the recourse to make it happen? And maybe this is the motion to compel you to.
Motion to compel. You bring them back to court, ask the judge to order that spouse to do what that spouse is supposed to do. Ask for attorney's fees. Maybe you'll get them, maybe you won't.
Okay. Terry, this caller has an ex-boyfriend, or a child with an ex-boyfriend. How do I get child support?
Well, it kind of depends on whether this person is receiving any public benefits or not. If they are, then they can go to the Child Support Enforcement Agency office, and they would be what we call a 4D case. There's some federal rules that go with that, and can get some assistance. It may take a while. They can also file a petition to establish paternity and child support. If the mother who has the child does not want the father involved in that child's life, then she should think twice about asking for child support. Because with child support comes, that doesn't come until there's a finding of paternity, that the dad is the dad, and with that comes rights for that parent, for that father.
Okay. Cheryl, here's a question. How can I be sure that my ex is spending the child support on the kids?
You can't be sure that the ex is spending the child support on the kids. The reality is child support very likely is being spent on the children. Child support covers more than what many fathers or some fathers think. It's not just the food that goes into that child's mouth or the clothes that are put on the back, but it's also supposed to cover other things like a part of the mortgage or the rent payment, the electric bill, the cell phone bill, even though this child doesn't use the cell phone. It's the total cost of having your child in your home. And the child support is set based upon the general statistical cost for raising a child at a particular income level. So there's a lot of thought that the legislator put into calculating the correct amount of child support for any particular situation.
Okay. And there are child support guidelines that,
correct.
And are those hard and fast, or can they be bent depending on the circumstance?
Well, they're hard and fast, but there's deviations from that based on certain circumstances. But it's not just child support. It's also contribution for medical insurance, for extracurricular activities, for child care, different things that go in to change that number. So it's a process. There's a calculator that can be used, but it doesn't take into account any of those factors for deviation.
Okay. One last question. Cheryl, how long am I required to pay spousal support?
You're required to pay spousal support for as long as the court order says. There's a lot of factors that go into that, and it's probably something you should talk to a lawyer about.
Okay. Well, that is all the time that we have. Thank you to everybody who called in. Please join us next week when we answer your questions about impaired driving and the law. I'd like to thank both of you again for coming on tonight and answering our questions. And I'd like to thank the viewers for watching and taking the time to call. I'm Stephanie Balmer. Good night.